الله يا ربي يا الله، الله يا ربي يا الله.
لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، محمد رسول الله، محمد رسول الله.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله الأمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. حديث number 8 from الأربعين النووية. This hadith was narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him and with his father, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once said, I've been ordered to fight against the people until they testify that there's no one worthy of being worshipped except Allah the Almighty, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. And until they establish the salat and pay the zakat, and if they do that, then they will have gained protection from me for their lives and property, unless they commit acts that are punishable in Islam, and their reckoning will be with Allah. And this hadith was reported by al-Bukhari and Muslim. The hadith states that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was commanded to fight. Now, once people hear this, they will immediately start to raise question marks and point fingers and jump to the gun. Islam is a religion of violence. Islam was spread by the sword. They can say whenever they want, all the time. However, this would not change the reality that Islam is a balanced religion. It's a religion of peace and it's a religion of justice. And it's not a man-made religion. This is a religion from Allah the Almighty who created the heavens and the earth. And if you analyze and look in a holistic way, you will understand not only that, but you will appreciate the wisdom behind these hadiths. Islam is a balanced religion. The Prophet said, I was ordered, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to fight the people until they testify. Now, fighting is not something that is violent and unfair. It is violent in the sense that one party has to subdue the other. This is logical. That is why people fight. Yet fighting is not killing. Boxers are fighters and they do not kill one another, they fight. And fighting is not only for the disbelievers or for the non-Muslims. It can also be for the Muslims. Let's go back to square one. I've been ordered to fight the people. Who ordered the Prophet ﷺ to do so? It is Allah. No one orders the Prophet ﷺ except Allah the Almighty. So it is the command of Allah. And if you go to the Noble Quran, you will find the command of Allah to fight. Why do the Muslims fight? Is it to gain more area? Is it to have authority? Is it to gain more wealth and money? No. The fight of the Muslims is only to implement the law of Allah the Almighty that frees the people from worshipping human beings into worshipping Allah the Almighty. And this is the cause and the reason. The Prophet says, I've been ordered to fight the people until they testify that there is no God worthy of being worshipped except Allah. So these are the three things that he was ordered to do, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was ordered to fight until the people believe in Allah and his messenger, pray, and give zakat. That is it. Okay, then what is this? What kind of fighting is this? In Islam, jihad, the most famous word that non-Arabs know and non-Muslims know, thinking that it is associated with terrorism, Jihad is a noble cause, and this is not the right time to go in detail, though I would love to, but jihad is to fight the disbelievers. Jihad is to fight one's own whims and desires. Jihad is to fight the hypocrites by exposing them. Jihad is to fight and oppress the devils and the Satans around us. So it has many forms and means of fighting. In Islam, jihad is divided into two types, defensive and offensive. The defensive side of it, no one argues about its legitimacy. If someone invades your country, if someone attacks you, if someone attacks a group of Muslims, it is a fard for them to defend themselves and to fight back, providing that this would not lead to their total annihilation. This is defensive jihad, and this is understandable and recognizable. No one tells an oppressed nation to sit back and relax and watch the invaders coming and taking their wealth and their territories and enslave them. So this is their God-given right. Offensive jihad is not applicable nowadays, not because it goes against international laws, but because the Muslim communities, the Muslim rulers, the Muslim countries are not abiding by Islam. So how can they be expected to spread Islam? But in ideal situations, when we have a sovereign, strong, Muslim practicing country, the ruler is obliged to go and wage offensive jihad, offensive wars, not to kill people, but rather to spread the word of Islam. And this is what the Prophet used to do, alayhi salatu wasalam. He used to send his troops and he used to tell them, give them the choice of three. One, embrace Islam. If you accept Islam, you're one of us. We'll leave you alone, keep the land, keep everything, we're gone. If they refuse, then tell them, you have to pay taxation, known as jizya. It's a minimal amount of money. By this money, you get to stay in your country, enjoy your lives. Not only that, if attacked by any other nation or powers, you don't have to fight. It is our responsibility to defend you. We will die defending your country. And if they refuse to accept Islam and to pay the taxation or the jizya, then we have to fight them until they submit. This is the rule of Islam. And whether you like it or not, this is what's being applied nowadays. Even non-Muslim countries are doing the same. 100 years ago, they invaded almost all of the Arabian and the Muslim world. Look at what Britain, Portugal, Spain, Holland, Germany, Italy, look, and France definitely. Look what they had done to Morocco, Algiers, Libya, Egypt, Sudan, the African continent, to India, to Pakistan, to Bangladesh, to Indonesia, and the list goes on and on. They've invaded these countries. And these people, the invaders, were not Muslims. But it is built in them to conquer, to invade, and to rob the nations from their wealth and to take anything that they can take away. They've enslaved the Arabs, the Muslims, for so many decades. And now they claim that Islam is a barbaric religion. It is not. Islam does not call for the power of people. It does not call to enslave people. It does not call to gain more and more territories. On the contrary, so many incidents in history prove that the Muslim armies were told to retreat and to surrender what they have conquered because they betrayed a treaty or they did not say the truth. And this caused the invaded nation to accept Islam when they saw this and they said, this cannot be in normal laws. This has to be a divine law. So the Prophet tells us, alayhi salatu wasalam, I've been ordered to fight with the people, not to kill them. And we will elaborate a little bit further after the break, so stay tuned.
Allahu, Allahu, ya Rabbi, ya Allah.
The night of decree is better than a thousand months. The benefits of worship and the vigil in the night of power.
Ramadan, which is the topic of the show. Do you have any advice for our viewers?
Asad Ahmad.
Especially in the blessed month of Ramadan.
The Ramadan is the reminder of rectifying our behavior.
Dr. Ali Ali Shaban.
Ramadan is a unique opportunity for every Muslim.
And the reasons behind this revelation and its power emphasized as the human heart transcends towards godly glory.
If you apply Ramadan to the rest of the year,
Tariq Ali.
Surely you are going to be much, much better in all fields, all aspects.
And the gratitude of the soul reaches out to worship the Almighty One on this esteemed night.
Just to stick more and more or time to the Holy Quran.
Dr. Muhammad Ibrahim.
This is my advice to all my Muslim brothers.
Let's strive to seek the night of power and its bliss in Blessed Nights every Friday at 4:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 3:30 a.m. India on Peace TV. Dialogue. Discussion. Debate. Rebuttal. Conclusion.
Eliminate misconceptions about religion. Get enlightened.
Witness Dr. Zakir Naik in a battle of words in Crossfire every Saturday at 8:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 10 a.m. India on Peace TV.
A servant is not afflicted with any punishment greater than having a stiff heart and being away from the Almighty, the Compassionate. Hearts are God's vessels on the earth. The most beloved ones to Him are the softest and the most purest. If hearts are nourished with God's remembrance and quenched with His meditation, it will witness great wonders and deep wisdom. Since our hearts are enlaced with layers of oblivion, we need to cleanse them to stand sound and pure before Allah. To know more, join us on Peace TV's new series on Healing Hearts, where we can join together the caravan of the sincere servants of Allah.
Let's try and purify our hearts from all destructive sins to taste true success in Healing Hearts, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. So the Prophet tells us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that Allah commanded him to fight the people until they accept Islam. And this, as illustrated before the break, is not a choice that you have to make it or you die. There's no compulsion in religion. We all know that. And there is no compulsion. You have a choice of three things. Either you accept Islam, or you pay the taxation, or you face the Muslim army. And as stated before, this type of offensive jihad does not exist nowadays. It will come back with the grace of Allah Azza wa Jal when the Muslims go back to their religion. And this is why everyone tries their level best not to have the Muslims go back to their religion. Not knowing that when the Muslims abide by the Quran and the Sunnah, peace and security would be spread all over the world, as it was at the time of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. Within 100 years of the beginning of the message of Islam, 3/4 of the world were Muslim. And the whole earth did not see such peace, justice, fairness, and prosperity throughout the whole world. Fighting is not only with the disbelievers, and this shows you the fairness and justice of Islam. Fighting is also with the Muslims. Allah mentions in Surah Al-Hujurat that when two factions of the Muslims fight against each other, we have to try to reconcile between them. And if one of these factions is the oppressor and it transgresses over the other, it is our duty to fight this oppressing force. They're Muslims. It is mandatory upon us to fight them, because Allah does not allow oppression, and we have to bring matters back to justice and fairness. So fighting is not only with the disbelievers. Fighting is to establish the law of Allah, not to establish the law of individuals, not to worship individuals. It is to free the people from being enslaved to their systems or to man-made laws. Again, Islam is not an oppressing religion. Each and every individual is entitled for a fair trial. You cannot convict people without trying them. Islam does not permit you to do this. And this is why the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says in the hadith, "And if they do so, then they will have gained protection from me for their lives and property." If they accept Islam, they've got protection from all the Muslims. No one can do anything to them, and their lives and property are in safe hands, unless they commit acts that are punishable in Islam. And even if a person commits an act that is punishable in Islam, he would not be convicted unless tried. When it comes to the law of Allah the Almighty that prohibits the killing of children, of women, of the elderly, of people of religion, monks and priests, Islam prohibits all of this. Nobody highlights this. They only highlight what they like, and they only try to deflect and repel people from looking into what Islam is really about. Islam is a religion of peace. Islam is a religion of balance, and it is a religion of justice and fairness. So the Prophet says, alayhi salam, "I will fight the people until they believe that there is no God worthy of being worshipped except Allah the Almighty, and that Muhammad is his messenger. And these go side by side. If you believe in the existence of Allah and his oneness, but you refuse to believe in the message of the Prophet alayhi salam, you're not a Muslim, and you have to be, or you have to submit your will to the Almighty by believing in the message of the Prophet alayhi salam. Not only that, you have to establish prayer, and you have to give the alms or zakat. What is the prayers to be established? What are they? They are the 5 daily prayers. Originally, they were mandated as 50. And this is the only thing that was mandated in the 7th heaven, directly without the message of Jibreel, the archangel, peace be upon him. And this highlights the importance of prayer. Everything else was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ through Jibreel, the messenger of Allah. Except prayer, the Prophet ﷺ took the instruction directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without any mediators. And it was 50 at the very beginning. And when he met Moses, peace be upon him, on the 6th heaven, he told him, "Go back and ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to reduce it, because I know the sons of Israel, and they're stubborn, and your people are not so far from that. They will not be able to pray 50 prayers a day." So the Prophet ﷺ kept on going back and forth until it finally settled to be 5 prayers, from 50 to 5 prayers. So the Prophet ﷺ tells us that he was commanded to fight people until they testify the testimony, and they pray. They establish the 5 daily prayers. And who will gain from these prayers? Tom, Dick, or Harry? Who will gain? Allah will gain from it? No. The prayer is for your self-purification, to get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. It helps you do what Allah commands, and it helps you to stay away from haram. And that is why those who pray five times a day, you will not find them lying or cheating or consuming intoxicants or fornicating or dealing in riba. Why? Because the prayer disciplined them. And this is something between you and Allah. However, it is the most important form of worship in Islam, to the extent that if a person does not pray, he's not a Muslim. Even if he says La ilaha illallah, even if he says it 100 times, he's not considered to be in Islam as a Muslim. Because the Prophet told us والسلام, that between man and kufr, that is disbelief, or shirk, that is associating others with Allah, between man and these two things is abandoning prayer. And then the Prophet says, والسلام, and they should give zakat. And what is zakat? As mentioned before, zakat is one of the pillars of Islam. It's the third pillar of Islam. Whenever you find prayer is mentioned in the Quran, most likely you'll find it also associated with giving zakat, because zakat is a financial form of worship. With it, prosperity is spread among the Muslims. It's a minimal amount taken from the rich, given to the poor. And it's literally given to the poor in the sense that if you have savings, cash, that exceeds the price of 595 grams of silver, and this remains with you a whole lunar year, after 1 year, you have to give 2.5%. So if you have $100, this is 2.5. If you have $100,000, this is $2,500 to be given to the poor. And this was mentioned in verse 60, chapter 9, the eight categories of receiving zakat. Who should we give zakat to? It was mentioned in the Quran. Also, the Prophet says, alayhi salatu wasalam, if they do so, then they will have gained protection from me for their lives and property unless they commit acts that are punishable in Islam, and their reckoning will be with Allah. Which means that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam only judges what he sees. As for the people's intentions, this is for Allah, and they will be accountable for what they believe. And that is why the hypocrites used to come to the Prophet ﷺ, and they used to say, we bear witness that there is no God worthy of being worshipped except Allah, and that you are the messenger and servant of Allah. And they used to come and pray in the masjid, and Allah tells us in the Quran, and Allah testifies that they are liars, they are hypocrites, they are in the bottom level of hell. Why didn't the Prophet kill them, alayhi salam? Because he was only commanded to judge people by their appearance, by their actions, not by their intentions. And this cascades down to us. I don't have the right to come and say, this man, he has ill intent. He's deviant because he has in his heart this and this and this. This is not my right, because I only judge what appears to me. And that is why when Usama ibn Zayd, may Allah be pleased with him and with his father, went into expedition with the army of the Muslims and came back victorious, he was telling the Prophet ﷺ, we did this, and the Prophet was very happy because they were victorious. And then when Usama was telling the Prophet ﷺ, there was a man killing the Muslims, a brave warrior. So I had a duel with him and we exchanged blows, and then he was cornered and he felt that I will defeat him and kill him. And just I was getting there, he said, La ilaha illallah. So I knew that he said this only to protect himself. So I stabbed him and killed him. The Prophet, when he heard this, his face changed. And he said, you killed him. After he said, La ilaha illallah. Now imagine the scenario. The man is in war, in battle, in a duel. He's fighting, people are dying. And this disbeliever, who is an enemy, when he felt that he was going to be killed, he said, La ilaha illallah. What would you have done? You and I probably would have done the same. Yet the Prophet corrected it and said, you killed him when he said, La ilaha illallah. So Usama said, Prophet of Allah, he was defending himself. He wasn't embracing Islam, he's an enemy. He said, what will you do on the day of judgment when La ilaha illallah comes? The one that he stated. Did you open his chest and see that he was lying or not? This is something only Allah knows. So he kept on repeating it and repeating it. and he was reprimanding Osama for what he had done. Therefore, the reckoning is only to Allah. We judge people by their actions and deeds, by what we see, not by what is in their heart. And from this hadith, we learn that on the day of reckoning, the people would see good or evil that what they had done, even if it was the weight of an ant of good, they will see it. And if it's the weight of an ant of evil, they will see it. This is all the time we have until we meet you next time. Fi amanillah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allahu, Allahu, ya Rabbi, ya Allah. Allahu, ya Rabbi, ya Allah.
La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Muhammadun Rasulullah.